Welcome to the fifth installment of the Asterisk Years interviews. My name is Graham Wilson, and joining me today, of course, is the man himself behind this fantastic effort, the green and white writer himself, Mr. Paul Larkin. Hail, hail, Paul.
Hail, hail, Graham.
Great to have you with us once again to talk about this effort that is spanning so many different mediums now. We started with the book, and that got obviously just fantastic response from that. Last time we spoke, you were just launching the audiobook for the Asterisk Years. Tell us what the response has been and some of the feedback that you've gotten.
Very good, actually. It's probably not had any bad reviews yet, which makes a change, you know. There's always
sure.
a few, but I think it's been very good. I think it's I'm certainly not aware of, in the kind of circles that I move in, or in, whether it be in real life or social media, of people who do audiobooks and stuff. So it's I think it's probably a relatively new medium for a lot of people. Clearly, we were always kind of looking at that, but it was kind of propelled by the fact that, you know, a couple of people who were sight problems and issues and stuff like that were saying about books and what they could do, and thought, right, here's something we can do. Now, obviously, it was done by myself and Richard, and then it was extended to people like yourself and Yompe and all sorts of people. And for the minute that dropped on just before Christmas there, it's been a really good kind of response. I mean, I think it's a bit like any book, you know. You didn't get a response for 2-3 weeks or whatever, and things like that. And I'm sure Richard will tell you, you even get people who buy the book and then just forget to download it. And mentioning their name is Joe McKenna. But, so that's these things that I undo. But I think I was really proud of the project with it, and a really fantastic response to it. And it's good to kind of have that other medium to try and get the story out, because at the end of the day, that's the most important thing, is the story.
No question. And, you know, the thing that I was most struck by was the quality of all of the work. I mean, you had some contributions from so many different people. And, you know, that I think really added to the spice of the story. You know, you were able to give some color to the words on the page and really get a sense of the feeling from so many different people. Which I think really supplemented it. And it's also an opportunity. You know, we've talked about books in the past where, you know, you put things to paper and then you think, right, you know, maybe I could have put that, you know, wee bit extra into it, or new things come to light and you add into it. And for me, it was almost like there was an opportunity there for you to do that.
Yeah. I mean, the idea kind of with this project was to, you know, put some of the sort of smoking guns in the book and then kind of stylize it a bit more for the audiobook, then throw more smoking guns into the documentary. I mean, that was always the case. And, you know, sometimes with an audiobook, you're obviously reading it and things didn't read as well as you might have liked in the first place. And that's something you can miss when you're actually writing it, because when you're writing it, you're just kind of buried real deep inside it. And
yeah.
So, you know, you can often kind of miss stuff and whatever and think, oh, that doesn't really work. But in second reading, you think, oh, God, no, I wish I'd written that or something. With an audiobook, that allows you the chance to kind of iron out some of the things. It also allowed us to take out some stuff that perhaps wasn't as relevant to the actual theme of the story. It was mere put in for sort of entertainment type value in the actual book.
Yeah.
And then throw in, you know, a few wee tweaks and stuff like that, and give the wee added extras towards the audiobook that, you know, people who are really as deep into the project as I am in terms of, you know, devouring the stuff that comes out and stuff, to give them something that's a bit added extra for their money.
Mm-hmm.
And the purpose, I mean, again, the purpose of it was and is to kind of was to help the project move on. That's why there was never any intention to even see it as a kind of money-making scheme where you say, like, oh, we'll charge, you know, 12, 13, 14 pounds or whatever.
Right.
It was always to be as low cost as it could possibly be, so it could just add to the funds that were going to go in the kind of documentary pot, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people kind of appreciated that. It's a kind of case of, well, it's only a fiver, even if it's rubbish, you know what I mean?
Right.
So it's been really good, and it's, you know, as I say, the important thing in all this is to try and get people to get their head around this story and this kind of things that we're trying to say. And I think we've had a lot of victories in that regard, you know, where it has slipped into the mainstream in bits and pieces and all that kind of thing. And and that's been a real victory for everybody involved, you know.
Sure, absolutely. You know, a couple of points that you bring up there, you know, the pricing of the audiobook I think was advantageous because, you know, as we've been alluding to, even if you read the book, there were still things that could supplement your reading from that audiobook download and from listening to it. So, you know, to your point, it is almost like a supplement, and it listens a bit differently than it reads off of the paper. And, you know, to your point again, reaching and lifting up this message to as many people as possible and getting it to click. I think that's the important thing to as many people as possible to create that awareness, I think is crucial to this project. And it's going to another level with this forthcoming documentary. Let's talk about this a bit. I know you have a trailer that's being worked on and it's on the way shortly, but what are some of the challenges putting together this documentary that, you know, is seeking to raise that level of awareness and that level of medium once again?
Money. That's a huge challenge.
It's not cheap. Yeah.
The egos are a huge challenge because there's a huge difference with people's involvement when they're actually going to appear on screen. And then, you know, suddenly people were like, oh, well, you know, I need to do this and I need to do that and that kind of thing. That's hard. For me, the challenge is to get it right. You know, this is something that, I mean, it's an absolutely colossal project. I mean, you know, you could probably sit for about 3 weeks and put a kind of documentary type thing together that you could put on YouTube and, you know, just fire it out and that would be fine. But you couldn't. The most important thing is to try and get the message out, and it's something that we've talked about a lot in terms of how do you actually do that. You know, there are other ways and means to actually do that. You doesn't always have to be in your face. You can try and entertain people as well. So what I tried to do sort of over the period of January was to try and get a lot of the hard stuff out of the way in the sense of the footage that was needed and the places we needed to film and stuff like that.
Sure.
Because, you know, at the end of the day, I mean, and this has been really apparent this month, is to be involved in this, you need to really have a bit of steel in your spine. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't just I've witnessed people who have just backed away because they see the enormity of the project and they see the enormity of the enemy.
Yeah.
And that's something that it's, you know, as you dig deeper and deeper into this thing, you get a sense of more and more of the people that you're actually up against.
Right.
And it's kind of like, you know, there's a number of things that I've done it, but it's one of the reasons why I try my very, very best to never really get involved in these huge sort of social media debates you see about CS4 and that, because I know who the real enemy is, and it isn't anybody in a green and white shirt, you know what I mean?
Right.
So the challenge is to make it right, to make it no look some amateurish garbage that anybody could put together, and to bring it onto a level that actually can be sort of spat out in the mainstream and make it viable to show anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Now, no, that is not an easy thing to do, because obviously that takes money, and I'll come onto that in a bit, but you know, there are people, you know, we can like it or no, we can say what we want. There are people out there who absolutely, positively, 100% do not want this project to work.
And they'll do whatever they can to stop
it. Yes. An example of which, because it really hasn't really affected me. I mean, I would say there's probably at least two people involved in a project who have been, in the last month or so, been threatened because of their involvement in it. And I didn't mean by, oh, we'll punch your face in it. I mean, like, in terms of we'll actually destroy your life,
mm-hmm.
type thing. And I think they've probably been sort of reserved and nobody didn't know what to tell me that and all that kind of thing. But you know yourself, when somebody just changes, boom, overnight, you know there's an issue.
Of course.
But for me, personally, I mean, I've not really had sort of anything in that vein until this week, where I phoned up a prominent sort of cinema in the west of Scotland, and the woman said she was expecting my call. And I, when, where? And of course, at that point, you know, I was in college, and I was, you know, And she said, "Oh, this is a David Murray film, isn't it?" So I was right, well, is it? Okay, well, I didn't realise that, but go on. And suddenly, everything that was quoted in the documents that had been given by them, you know, PDFs of hiring and all that kind of thing, had changed. And that they would be requiring security deposits, and they would be you'd be able to show on a weekend, and it wouldn't be this, and it wouldn't be that. And it was just like, somebody's got to you, haven't they? What do you mean? What do you mean? And I was like, come on, I've been in the game long enough to know when somebody's heart turns to stone, you know what I mean? You didn't know me, so you can't hate me, you know? So what is the issue? And she said that one of their main sponsors had given a kind of ultimatum of sort of over their dead body, would this film be shown here? So, you know, these are the sort of challenges that you face, and I'll be honest, it sometimes leads to people saying, oh, you know, why should we bother? Whereas I'm the kind of person who says, that's why we should bother.
Exactly.
That's the reason there, and that's why I say that if you're going to be involved in this project, you need two things, basically. You need the skills that we need that can put something in the movie, and you need the balls to actually see it through.
Right.
And can I get me wrong? Not an easy thing. Wouldn't suggest it whatsoever. But, you know, and then, of course, there's the odd snipe here and there, the usual stuff, you know. I mean, people I've never met in my life before can't even ever think I've had any contact with, dialogue with, anything like that. And then somebody will come for, oh, so-and-so was bad-mouthing you or saying this or saying that. And it's kind of like water off a duck's back now, really. It's always designed to derail you off the things that you're doing. But, you know, as I've always said, the support always far outweighs that. You know what I mean? It's people that are intelligent enough to understand that, you know, what we're trying to do here is huge. And it's probably, and it's certainly beyond me as an individual, that's for sure. And there's absolutely no way on earth I could do this on my own. So I'm 100% reliant on the kind of Celtic support backing this project, helping me, giving me, you know, the skills that they can use and whatever they can be and all that kind of thing. And I know that some people I can take the bullets and dodge them as well, whereas I know for some people it's a bit scary sometimes when, you know, they get involved and suddenly, you know, something happens that they just, you know, kind of the dark arts come into play. But
right.
There are plenty of people out there who are not like that, who don't care, and you know, that's the biggest weapon we have against the kind of people like the Edinburgh establishment, you know.
Sure. And something that is present to me just in hearing about, you know, what you're dealing with in terms of dealing with cinemas and vendors and so on. How important is it to be able to work with people that you trust? And I don't mean, you know, people that are working both sides of the fence. I mean, we know, you know, who's on our side and who's not, but I'm talking about people that, you know, when they get involved with projects like this, oftentimes it's a bit overwhelming. This is a huge effort, and, you know, it is hard to just sort of, you know, zip it up, you know, and not tell people intricate details about what's going on, because, you know, you tell one person, you know, yourself, you tell one person and then everybody finds out about it. And
yeah.
I mean, tell us a little bit about that element and some of your thoughts on that.
You're right. I mean, that is absolutely crucial in it. I mean, you know, people can come forward and say they want to help, but like, if you didn't know them, then it's a hell of a lot of trust you're putting in them, you know? Because clearly the point is if stuff gets out, it's going to be in this film before it gets out in the film, then it gives them a chance to try and stop it. And that's not what we want, you know what I mean? What if basically present a fait accompli and then kind of go out and that kind of thing? I mean, you know, we did, someone who was close to the project has really let us down badly, you know, really let us down badly. And that's something that was really unfortunate. Not so much revealing stuff, but more in the sense of really letting us down at a time when, you know, we just didn't need it. The flip side of that might be that actually, because, you know, from that kind of dead flower, if you like, you know, a daffodil has sprung up, and therefore it might have actually been the best thing that happened to us. But it's still hurtful, you know what I mean? Because yeah. People put a lot of work and effort and time and money into stuff, and they get fucked over, and that's never helpful. So, you know, there's, it's not without issues and it's not without fucking, you know, difficulties and all that kind of thing. So what I would say to anybody listening to this now is, if you want to get involved in this thing, by all means, come forward. And if you've got the skills and the balls that you think you can add something to this project, by all means, get forward. But what we would expect of you, apart from those skills and having that those kind of balls, is to actually, you know, give 100% effort and 100% respect and trust to us, because, you know, a lot of people's lives literally are on the line here. You know what I mean? A lot of people have committed a lot of things that if this fails, you know, could easily ruin them. And I have to carry about that with me every single day, you know. And we, even in the last week, because of the letdown we had a hellish week, an absolutely hellish week. And I was, for at least 2 days, thinking, oh my God, I've let everybody down. This is going to be an absolute nightmare, blah, 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 blah. And I carry it all on me. Even though I don't think any of this letdown's my fault or the fault of anybody other than the person that let us down. So then you have to kind of regroup, re-energize yourself and kind of think, you know, well, why are we doing this again? And, you know, nothing good is ever easy. And I think it was Teddy Roosevelt that said, if you believe you can do something, you're halfway there. Yeah. Well, I believe we'll do this, and I believe we'll get the support that we need, and I believe that we'll find the venues in Scotland and Ireland and all that kind of thing, and America, whatever it might be, that'll show this thing.
Yeah.
They're out there. There are people out there who want to hear this story, who want to support the project and all that kind of thing. But, you know, we didn't need a bad apple, as you would say. And, you know, we've got great people, and but, as I say, you know, if you'd spoken to me yesterday, it'd probably been a hell of a lot more downbeat. Today, spoken to people that I know who are professionals in this kind of field in terms of film and producing and all that kind of thing, have a good few films under their belt, and they seem to be more than happy to take on the project, which is really, really fantastic, because then that'll guarantee a professional output. So who knows, you know, maybe for the first time in my fucking life, we might have actually got a break today.
Well, Paul, there's you mentioned believing in the project, and I think that there's so many people that also believe, not just, you know, in yourself. I mean, we certainly, you know, given the evidence that you've given us over the years in terms of, you know, bringing out such quality work, we believe in you, but we also believe in this project, and we believe, you know, just how important it is. And I think that's the type of movement and the type of effort that, you know, really just can't be broken, you know, to be honest. And here I just completely talked to Zero. Sorry about that, Paul. We just lost you briefly there for a second. But I was talking about, you know, how much we as a support believe in what you're doing. And you yourself, you know, the effort that you put in, and we know that, you know, this is going to be, you know, a fantastic work, something that, you know, is going to stand the test of time. I'm particularly excited because, you know, this is in the realm of, you know, the Michael Moore. You know, I mean, so much of the great effort that he put out with Fahrenheit 9/11, Bowling for Columbine, and then, you know, the documentaries that he put up right next to the books. You know, I mean, it's one thing to read the books, but when they came out, you know, it was so powerful, and it was done because, you know, of the perfection that he required in it. And I think, you know, I know that you have that same element as well. You touch on a couple of interesting points in terms of the participation and the reluctance of some. You know, this is not sitting in your living room and putting words onto a laptop or even recording. This is out in the public, in the open. It's the use of video. And I've seen it myself where there is some reluctance to participate with it. You know, oh, I don't look right, or oh, I'm not good on camera, or things. You know, there's all sorts of insecurities that people bring when you talk to them about a film documentary. How do you overcome that? How do you convince them that, you know, they need to be part of this project, and that, you know, just sort of quell their fears or their concerns with that?
Well, I mean, first of all, you have to find the happy medium, because, you know, when you get these kind of things, you do find a lot of people who are completely withdrawn and not interested, and then there's a kind of prima donna element who just think the whole thing should be about them. And that sort of, I mean, listen, you know, I'm making this film and I'm not going to be in it very much, you know, probably 5 minutes if you're lucky. So it's not like this is all about me. It is not in the slightest. you have to make people realize that, you know, you never get anything in life unless you take a chance, you know? It's easy to sit fucking moaning and groaning about this, that, and next thing on Twitter and Facebook and all that kind of thing. This is real, and this is what we think you can strike a blow against them. Because this film, you know, you touched on Van 9/11. Now, if you look at the context of that at the time, that was right before the second election of Bush.
Right.
And it was clearly designed to derail that campaign. And being incidentally, people didn't realize Van 9/11 has actually never, ever been shown on American television.
Right.
You know, DVD, cinema, YouTube, never on American television. And on a smaller scale, that's the kind of level we're doing here, because what we're trying to do is stop the resurrection of David Murray, mm-hmm. which is getting damn close to happening.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he's getting closer and closer to coming back, and I'll touch on that in a minute. So if people actually didn't want that to happen, then here's a chance for them to say, look, that's it. Now, I can take on board all the criticism, any of the shit, any of the flack that flies. I know, you had another reminder this week, there is a few, two or three, maybe four, dedicated, sort of in brackets, Celtic supporters who absolutely hate me and are happy to talk shite about me on podcasts and blogs, etc., etc., etc. You know, and people could then repeat it to me, this, that, and that. I've got, what's, I couldn't give a fuck. What I'm interested in is the people that I know with the heart and soul of Celtic in them, this is their chance to actually fight back against what was an empire.
Mm-hmm.
And so what the Asterisk Years was always about was to kind of fire the shots. And it, as I say, it gets to the mainstream. I saw a journalist for a broadsheet newspaper lift a chapter of the Asterisk Years and put it in an article about David Murray. Now, two or three people noticed it. And I never mentioned it on Twitter or Facebook, nothing like that, and said, look at this prick, you know what I mean? That kind of way, where he's basically lifted this. And I'm like, are you kidding me on? This is fantastic. Do you understand that he has lifted words written by a headcase Celtic supporter for Edinburgh in an article about David Murray? You tell me when that would have happened a year ago, or 2 years ago, or 10 years ago. Never. That's the victories. You know what I mean? We then had a radio show that was on, and a discussion about Murray came up. And about four or five of the things that I'd never read anywhere but that were in the Asterisk Years were mentioned by a prominent pundit, you know? And so, and it was like, again, people saying, gee, what are you saying? Gee, what are you saying? I was saying, fantastic. That's the point. Get it into the mainstream and get people to understand that, you know, this is what he was doing, this is how he done it, and so on and so forth and all that kind of thing. The other thing about it is that, you know, sometimes it's hard to kind of frame the narrative of the whole thing. So you can actually get to a situation where people think that you think you're saying one thing, but people are just interpreting it as something else.
Right.
At one stage, what I want to make absolutely clear is at no stage is this in any shape or form a way of trying to vindicate the old board of the Kellys and Whites. Not a chance.
Mm-hmm.
What it's saying to them is, yes, People can say what they want, and say they can say, yes, they financially mismanaged the club, yes, they were completely and utterly no right for the club, and yes, Fergus was the best thing that ever happened to us.
Sure.
I probably didn't disagree with any of that. The point I am trying to make is that Rangers were just as bad.
Right.
But yet, the circumstances were, try and kill us, give them more credit.
Mm-hmm.
That's the issue we're trying to get out there. So, you know, you try and kind of frame these narratives and all that kind of thing. And that's it. So what we want to do is illustrate this whole kind of Murray empire in relation to Celtic. Because at the end of the day, that's what it's all about.
Mm-hmm.
You know? It's all about... I mean, even yesterday, I was saying, you know, thanks to Joe Ledley for scoring the goal that started the Rangers liquidation. Because I always think that when we went above them that night, that's when their problems really came... You know, the chickens came home to roost for them because they couldn't mask success on the pitch anymore.
That was the knife to the heart. You know, I mean, 6 weeks prior, you know, you heard on these podcasts and these radio shows you're talking about, there's no way that Celtic could ever come back. You know,
I mean, you know yourself, Graham. Whatever happens off the park will be masked by what happens on it. If the team's winning and playing well and scoring goals, nobody really cares about anything else.
Exactly right.
The minute it doesn't, then people start looking at other things. But when I put that tweet out, people were saying, no, that was when Stevie Chalmers scored in Lisbon. you know? And I'm like, aye, you know what? Because I wrote that, you know? It's like, people get, you see that fucking cunt trying to educate you about this? I'm like, I don't care. That's what I want people to say, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, listen, anybody who's seen me, I'm not a vain person, for Christ's sake. I'm an overweight, balding, touching 40-year-old fucking idiot, you know what I mean? I'm not, this is not a fucking vanity project, you know. I'm trying to inform as best as I can. And the best as I can is... That's my thing. You know, I get people saying to me all the time, but why do you go to the press for this? Well, fuck the press, you know what I mean? This is us. We're us. They're them. Let them, you know, never a twain should meet, that's it. You know? We're not going to the Sun, fucking the Daily Record, or any of that crap. You know what I mean? Let them, and bit by bit, we'll chip away at what they're trying to say.
Yep.
So, at the end of the day, it's all about the story, and it's all about the revelations in the story, old, new, whatever, and to keep the pressure on them to ensure that they can never, ever come back. I mean, look at what we've got now in the situation. You know, we've got this whole Craig White thing, and Craig White is featured in a documentary. I will reveal that right now. That we have a Rangers director, Rangers new co-director, saying that he's going to throw him down the marble staircase at Ibrox.
That seems reasonable.
Craig White, and you know, that's fine, but Peter Lawwell makes one joke about Rory Bremner and Tony Blair, and that's, you know, got to start World War III in Scotland. I mean, it's all about the context, and so... At the end of the day, that's what this way is to try and stop them, because believe me, they are trying and trying and getting closer and closer to coming back and acting as though the whole thing never happened.
Yeah, it's such a great way of looking at things. You know, when you have your material lifted and you know, and as you have illustrated in some of these mainstream media outlets, I mean, you know, the natural response is, hey, am I going to get some credit for that? But you know, the way that you portray it is, you know, it's about the message, it's about getting it out there. And why would you want to stop them from, you know, from lifting the points that you're making to more people? You know, I mean, to a certain element, it gives more credence to what you're talking about to a wider audience. You know, I mean, the listeners of Super Scoreboard, by and large, are not going to be, you know, the readers of your book. But if they get that information, then all the better. You know, so let's get into the documentary itself, the bones of it, and how you're structuring it. What is the layout going to be similar to, you know, the book itself, or is it going to, you know, take on its own sort of nebulous form in the documentary with the same sort of the same information and elements with it?
No, I mean, there will be I mean, first of all, let me just touch on the credit thing. The answer to that is no. I won't get credit. I'm not looking for credit. And anybody who puts in a piece in a newspaper that says, because I was reading this book, let me tell you, it's a fluff piece designed to sell the book. End of story, right? So that's never going to happen. And I talk to journalists all the time. Some that would probably shock people. Doesn't mean I'm like, you know, saying to them, oh, please go and mention the book in this column and that kind of thing, because you'll not get a journalist in Scotland that can say that, because I've never said it to any of them. In terms of the documentary, we're going to move on. We're going to illustrate some of the thing. I want to take you inside the world of the Edinburgh establishment. I want to illustrate. I want to show you where these people live, where they work, who they are. I want to give you better visualisation of the stuff that was in the Asterisk Years book in terms of the bank support, the credit lines and all that kind of thing. We want to show you some new stuff that we've been working on for the best part of 6 months. Something that might interest you, we'll be able to reveal the real reason that Bill Miller didn't buy Rangers.
Very interesting. My buddy Bill Miller. Excellent.
Bill Miller of the famous incubation plan, which I'm interested in because it was a Celtic supporter that stopped him. And I heard that story and I thought, no, this cannot be true. And I got the guy and I spoke to the guy and I said, how did you manage to stop Bill Miller buying Rangers? And he said, because I fucking hate them and wanted them to die. And I thought, that's great. Now, if that was, you know, Joe Soap for Easter House, no problem. This guy's a big hitter in America, so yeah. I'm delighted with that.
Sure.
So that was good.
And it wasn't me. It wasn't me, by the way.
No, I said he was a big car. it was Jompy. No, it was Dr. J. It was a name that nobody will know, but it was someone who you wouldn't mess with, put it that way. So that's good. Other things. We'll present the evidence that shows David Murray runs Craig White.
Which I think is something that, you know, many people have assumed or, you know, just thought was going on in the background. But, you know, to have some sort of concrete link there, I think is really going to blow the lid off of everything.
This is something I've spoken about pretty much on every show I've been on here, is that I said that I think that you'll find at some point David Murray runs Craig White, but I can't prove that. Well, I think we can prove it now. And we can prove it in a way where we had a lot of help for someone in particular who has just been an absolute star in the help in terms of the research of this documentary. And that we were able to unlock an elaborate sort of system that David Murray had, which allowed him to basically hide in plain sight. Mm-hmm. With certain things, and we were able to decode it because he made one crucial error in this whole. So, you know, in other words, it would be like if you were reading a book about, you know, the life story of Frank Sinatra, and then somebody at the end said, actually, that book was about Dean Martin, you know, you'd be, holy shit, you suddenly view it in a different way. That's what happened in this context, is that Murray had an elaborate system to kind of hide in plain sight that we managed to decode. Because of a mistake that he made, and that led us to the information that proved that he ran Craig White, or has been running Craig White for the get-go, and that's something that we'll be able to put in the documentary after a lot of legal wrangling, let me tell you.
I'm sure.
But that's something that will go in, and that will, you know, it will be an put it this way, it will be an interesting insight into the relationship between Murray and Craig White. Because I think you'll see Craig White in a different light when you see this stuff.
Well, it also gives us some sort of roadmap for how close David Murray is to coming back, and maybe, you know, the channels that he's going to use to come back.
Well, here's the thing. How do you come back when you've never been away?
Well, it's all perception, isn't it? You know, it's all, you know, even though he has been there the whole time, the impression, and the impression needed to be, that he was away. So how does he smooth over that sort of renewal, or that reconciliation coming back, you know, so that it's acceptable, you know, to the supporters? I mean, you know, keep in mind, he took all sorts of abuse when, you know, Craig White came in and they died. But how does he come back, you know, well, in a way that's acceptable?
Yeah, well, let's paint a hypothetical scenario then. You're right. So at the end of 2011, Murray goes, and in inverted back, to, and it's toxic, mm-hmm. right? I mean, he's toxic amongst the, you know, the rank and file kind of Ranger support. So how do you go from being toxic to be, please come back? If that was me, what I'd probably do in that situation would be to introduce a series of complete and utter no-marks who run the new club into the ground and are faced with a situation that unless somebody comes in and basically bails us out, we are fucked again. Mm-hmm. That would be what I would do. Yeah. David Murray, I'll leave it to the listener.
Like the, you know, just coming back and now he's the savior. Because, I mean, let's be honest, you know, Sevco, as they are right now, they're on the balls of their ass. I mean, they're looking for anybody. You know, Dave King, I mean, please, they're looking for anybody to come and save them. You know, and this is essentially a medium, you know, where that can essentially filter through. It's great stuff here. We're joined by the Green and White writer himself, Paul Larkin, talking about the Asterisk Years documentary. We're going to take a quick break, play a quick tune. When we come back, I want to hear, you know, some more of the revelations coming through, you know, with this project, as well as, you know, how anybody can get involved with it. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
What y'all thought y'all wasn't gonna see me? I'm the Osiris of this shit. Wu-Tang is here forever, motherfuckers. This 97, I, my niggas and my niggerettes, let's do it like this. I'ma rub your ass in the moonshine. Let's take it back to 79.
I bomb atomically, Socrates. theories, philosophies, and hypotheses. Can't define how I be dropping these mockeries. Lyrically perform armed robbery. Flee with the lottery. Possibly they spotted me. Battle scarred, shogun, explosion when my pen hits. Tremendous. Ultraviolet shine, blind forensics. I inspect view through the future, see millennium. Killer bees sold 50 gold, 60 platinum. Shackling the matches with drastic rap tactics. Graphic displays melt the steel like blacksmiths. Black Wu jackets, queen bees ease the guns in. Rumble with patrolmen, tear gas, lace the function. Heads by the score, take flight inside a war. Ticks hit the floor, die hard fans demand more. Behold the bold soldier, control the glow slowly. Proceeds the blow, swinging swords like shinobi. Stomp grounds and found footprints in solid rock. Who got it locked, performing live on your hottest fly.
As the world turns, I spread like germ. Bless the globe with the pestilence. The hard-headed never learn. This my testament to those burned. Play my position in the game of life, standing firm. On foreign land, jump the gun out the frying pan. Into the fire, transform into the ghost rider. A six-pack and a street car named Desire. Who got my back in the line of fire, holding back? What? My peoples, if you with me, where the fuck you at? Niggas is strapped and they trying to twist my beer cap. It's court adjourned for the bad seed from bad sperm. Herb got my wig fried like a bad perm. What the blood? Clots. We smoke pot and blow spots. You wanna think twice? I think not. The iron lung ain't got to tell you where it's coming from. Guns of Navarone tearing up your battle zone. Rip through your slums.
I twist darts from the heart. Try to intrude. Loop my voice on the LP. Martini on the slang rock. Certified chatterbox. Vocabulary Donna talking. Tell your story walking. Take cover, kid. What? Run for your brother, kid. Run for your team. And your six camp rhyme groupies. So I can squeeze with the advantage and get wasted. My deadly notes reign supreme. Your fort is basic compared to mine. Domino effect, arts and crafts. Paragraphs contain cyanide. Take a free ride on my thought. I got the fashion catalog for all y'all that all praise due to God.
The saga continues. Wu-Tang, Wu-Tang.
Olympic torch flaming. We burn so sweet. The thrill of victory. The agony defeat. We crush slow. Flaming deluxe slow. Poor. Judgment day cometh. Conquer. It's war. Allow us to escape hell. Globe spinning bomb. Pocket full of shells out the sky. Golden arms. Tune spit the shitty Mortal Kombat sound. The fake ball step make the blood stain the ground. A jungle junkie. Vigilante tantrum. A death kiss. Catwalk. Squeeze another anthem. Hold it for ransom. Tranquilize with anesthesias. My orchestra, graceful, music ballerinas. My music Sicily, rich California smell. An axe kill adventure, paint a picture well. I sing a song from Sing Sing, sipping on Jing Sing. Righteous wax, chaperone, rotating ring
march
kings.
On the wooden soldiers, see cypher punks couldn't hold us. 1,000 men rushing in, not one nigga was sober. Perpendicular to the square, we stand gold like flare. Escape from your dragon's lair. In particular, my beats travel like a vortex. Through your spine, to the top of your cerebral cortex. Make you feel like you busting up from raw sex. Enter through your right ventricle, clog up your bloodstream. Hot terminal like Grand Central Station. Program fat basslines on ovation. Getting drunk like a fuck, I'm ducking 5-year probation.
War of the masses, the outcome disastrous. Many of the victim families saved the ashes. A million names on walls engraved in plaques. Those who went back received penalties for their acts. Another heart is torn, as close ones mourn. Those who strayed, niggas get slayed on a song.
The track renders helpless and suffers from multiple stab wounds and leaked sounds. That's heard 93 million miles away from K1 to represent the nation. This is a gathering of the masses that come to pay respects to the Wu-Tang Clan. As we engage in battle, the crowd now screams in rage. The hot chief Jamel Ari takes the stage. Light is provided through sparks of energy from the mind that travels in rhyme form, giving sight to the blind. The dumb are mostly intrigued by the drum. Death only one can save self from. This relentless attack of the track spares none.
Yo, 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 fuck that. Look at all these crab niggas laid back. Lampin' light and gray and black. Boom is on my man's rack. Codeine was tossing your drink. You had a navy green. Salamander fiend. Bitches overheard you scream. You two-faced and scum of the slum. I got your whole body numb. Blowing like Shalimar in 81. Sound convincing. $1,000 cork pop convincing. Hands like Sonny Liston. Give fly permission. Hold the fuck up. I'll fasten your wig. Bad luck. I'll humiliate. Separate the English from the Dutch. It's me. Black noble Ju Ali. Came of trees. We like the Genovese says so. Season these degrees is earth. 93 million miles from the first rough turbulence. The wave burst split the megahertz.
Hey yo, that's amazing. Gun in your mouth, talk, verbal foul hawk. Connect thoughts to make my man chow walk. Swift notarizer, blue tank, all up in the high riser. New York gang visor, word tranquilizer, just a dosage. Delegate my clan with explosives. Wow, my pen blow lines ferocious. Mediterranean, see y'all, the number one draft pick. Tear down the beat guard, the delegate, the guard, the seagull, the swift chancellor. Flex the white gold tarantula. Track truck diesel, play the weed guard. Substantial, max mostly, undivided, then slide it. Sickening, guaranteed, made him jump like Rod Strickland.
You're listening to the fifth installment of the Asterisk Years interviews. My name is Graham Wilson. Joining us is the man himself behind this colossal effort, the Green and White writer, Mr. Paul Larkin. Paul, thank you so much for joining us today, and you know, just some fantastic revelation. Are you? Can you hear me now?
No.
All right, we'll try and get him back. Having some Skype issues here today, so bear with us. Just talking to Paul about some of the new information that's coming out in the forthcoming documentary entitled The Asterisk Years, and just...
This is fucked.
Can you hear me now?
Hello?
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 Hello, do we have any audio?
I can hear you now, but I don't think anybody can hear us.
I'm pretty sure they can.
People, I've had DMs being saying you keep cutting out.
Well, you're coming through live now. I got the soundboard right in front of me, so it hasn't cut out at all throughout the entire show.
Fuck.
And I'm getting messages in the message board saying that it sounds good and we can hear you.
This is a nightmare. Oh, we've blown it.
All right, let's pick it up. Come on.
But I can't hear what you're saying. That's the problem.
You can't hear me right now.
No, but I can hear you now, but it cuts out. It cuts out every 5 minutes.
All right, well, we'll chuck it.
No, you can't chuck it.
Well, do you want to call me back then? I mean, the feedback that I'm getting through here is that the sound is fine. Can you hear me right now? All right, I don't know if we have him still. Are you there? Technical issues when you try and do a live show, ladies and gentlemen. But we will try our best. That's all we can do. It's not as easy as turning on a mic sometimes. But, you know, the internet is great when it works. And when it doesn't, it's inconvenient. We'll try Paul back here.
Hello?
Yeah. Are you there?
Yeah, I lost you completely again.
But we're good now.
Hello?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, you know, I...
Okay. All right, listen, let's go with it. And, you know, if it cuts out, it cuts out. But, you know, the feedback that I'm getting is it's fine. So, I don't know if it was cutting out for some folks, if they're listening, you know, on their phones or whatever, or, you know, the connection isn't going through, but... everybody that's giving me feedback in the message board says that it's fine.
But I can't hear it.
But you're hearing what I'm saying right now.
Yeah, but when it goes on live, it's cutting out all the time.
It's live now.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Are we good to go now?
Fine. Go.
All right. We're coming back from break, sorting out some technical issues. We're talking about some revelations that are coming out in this documentary here. Yeah, we lost them again. All right, we're gonna have to start over and you know, see what this Skype issue is. So we will come back for a part two of this, or maybe we'll just start over. I'm not sure, but stick with us. We'll come back here in some form. Paul, listen, we're just going to start over. We'll get this Skype issue sorted out somehow, and we'll start over, or, you know, whatever the case is. Can you hear me? Yeah, there's some sort of Skype issue going on. So apologies for the technical issues. It happens, but, you know, what can you do? We'll come back, and we'll do another one, and it'll be perfect. So, yeah, thank you so much for listening in to the practice run of this interview. And hey, Paul, listen, if you can hear me, we're gonna cut it off and then see if we can fix the Skype issue, and then we'll come back.
Well, I've got 3 texts here, people saying I'm cutting out all the time.
Okay. Let's just cut this off. We'll fix whatever the Skype issue is, and then we'll come back. You know, because. You know, obviously there's an issue with the connection or whatever it is. I'm getting, you know, feedback in the message board saying that the sound is fine. Yeah. All right. So, stick with us. Hope you enjoyed the practice run, and we'll come back and do it for real. See you.